But so yeah, it does seem like there's no shortage of creative things for us to do. We just had to kind of reassess what that meant, because if we stop and think about what we're supposed to be doing during this time, it's a crazy difference, you know, compared to what our lives were supposed to be like. But that's true for everyone. We've been working on some like remote recording things. Like we've come up with a couple of pieces that we could arrange for instruments that we could find around our house, like objects and stuff like that. And so we've been recording kind of one person at a time and then layering them together, shooting videos of it. So we're going to release some content like that.
Do you still have students?
Yeah, so I teach at the Manus Conservatory, which is one of the schools here, and I do have a bunch of students. Each student has a different thing that they need right now. Like some of the students don't have instruments at home, and so for them, I'm not really doing that much in the way of lessons with them because it's hard to really do that. So we're kind of postponing some of those things until next semester. I'm also working on some projects. Like I have this project I'm working on with one of the composition teachers at my school right now, where we're pairing up some of her composition students, some of my percussion students, to collaborate on like short miniature pandemic pieces. Like the composers will learn first about percussion instruments that are not traditional. So like wine glasses or silverware or trash cans or whatever these percussion students have on hand. And they'll spend some time talking about that and showing examples. And then little by little, the composer will write maybe a minute or 2 minute long piece that then the percussionists can spend some time learning. So just some kind of project to keep them engaged.
Do you give feedback to your students, like through Zoom or some other system?
Yeah, well, I mean, what I've found so far, I mean, many teachers have this really worked out much better than me. But what I've found is it's not that effective for me to be giving real-time feedback over Zoom with people playing. But what one could do if the student has instruments at home is they can make recordings of their performances, send them to me. Then we can get on Zoom and talk about various things, and we can have a bunch of sessions like that.
And so they would email you a recording,
Right.
for example, or Dropbox or whatever.
Yeah, but the percussion thing is so much different than many of the other instruments because, you know, they were kicked out of the school and kicked out of the practice facility, and that's where all the instruments are. Like most of the students don't have a marimba at home or anything like that, and so that's the really difficult part in our particular area. But it's I think we're all getting a lot better at it. I think by the end of this, people are going to be a lot more comfortable with that medium. It's not ideal at all, but I've also been heartened to see like lots of older generations taking to this. You know, people who have said in the past that they would never teach remotely or anything like that. I'm watching people like this give master classes for lots of people, and it is really cool to see people stepping up. I mean, the way I feel is just that I just feel bad for these students who are paying a lot of money to be at these schools, and they're not getting what they're supposed to be getting. And that's no fault of the schools, but they're not getting what they're supposed to be getting. And I think all of us who are teachers in this way should be doing everything that we can to try to make that at least a little bit better if we can.
Just jumping back to Sandbox,
Yeah.
do you guys qualify for any of those like small business loans that can be forgiven at?
Yeah, so this is kind of a new thing for me because I'm not one to espouse the benefits of what the government is doing for us. But actually, this law that Congress passed is super helpful for artists in a lot of ways. I mean, it's a little unclear because these programs have been rolled out so quickly, and some of the infrastructure that was required to organize them, what wasn't really there. But there are a couple programs from the Small Business Administration that directly would help small nonprofits like Sandbox. So it's open to nonprofits for the first time ever. So that's really wonderful. And for a small organization like us, even a small grant from them, like they're giving these loans that are forgivable if you meet certain criteria. And even a small grant from them is an incredible asset to an organization like that. The other thing that's been really interesting for artists like myself is unemployment insurance is available for folks like that who are self-employed, who are just performing all over the place. That's what they do. They're usually not eligible for unemployment insurance, but now they are. And that also seems to be a really meaningful thing to a lot of folks in my network.
Is that something that you could take advantage of?
I think so. I mean, it's a little complicated because I am still with Sandbox and I am teaching part-time as well. But because there is this big part of my career, like there are many concerts that were supposed to happen that I was budgeting for. And so I think they take all of that into account. And I think I would be eligible for something.
But talking about the difficulties of teaching virtually.
Yeah.
My guess is after this is all done, there are going to be some systems that are developed that are going to be certainly superior to Skype or Zoom to better meet the needs of musicians, for example.
Right, right. I would hope that's the case. You know, with Zoom, it's so funny. Like, I don't think that they were expecting for a couple billion people to start using Zoom immediately in the way that they're using it right now. But I would hope that at some point as we go through this, that some changes would be made to make it better. But like I say, it really depends on the hardware that you have available. Like, I've talked to a bunch of teachers who have developed great systems for it. Like, for example, if you have an external camera, even a webcam that you can put on top of your computer that's a little higher quality than the camera built into your laptop. And if you have a couple microphones, again, even if they're not high quality at all, they'll be way better than the microphones in your computer. Yeah. That's very easy to work into Zoom. And so I was touring, virtually touring a friend's sort of basement studio where he was teaching. He's a full-time professor, so he's teaching a lot of lessons every week. And he had like all his percussion instruments and a different mic on each one, a couple different cameras, so he could really, I think the students couldn't send him performances quite at the level that he was sending them, but in terms of him demonstrating to them, it seemed like it was at a really high quality.
And was the platform that he was using Zoom?
It is Zoom, yeah. So if you have some external things, whether they're mics or cameras, you can choose the input sources that Zoom uses. Like right now, we're probably both using just the built-in stuff in our computers, which is the default with Zoom, yeah.
I'm using an external camera.
Oh, you are? Okay, cool, got it.
Yeah, rather than what's on the laptop, because the one on the laptop doesn't work. But anyway, they always look like you're looking through the bottom of a Coke bottle or something.
Yes.
Are you practicing?
Not that much. No. What I did do, I brought home. I have a full size weighted synthesizer, and playing keyboard is something that I like to do just to kind of get off stress. So I brought that home and I have that. So I've been doing a little of that, which is fun. The only practicing I've been doing is like some of those recording projects I was mentioning with Sandbox. Like I've been playing a little bit in that way. I did bring home some sort of more portable instruments specifically for a couple of pieces that I've been meaning to learn but haven't learned yet. And so I do have those. They've kind of been sitting in my living room since I got home a few weeks ago, but I have them there whenever I get the urge.
Do you live in an apartment building?
Yeah, yes. My wife and I, we have a one-bedroom apartment. It's a small building. There's maybe 10 or 12 apartments in the building.
So if you were to practice, it potentially could be driving the people adjacent to you crazy?
I've actually lived in this apartment since 2011. And when I first moved in here, I didn't have my rehearsal studio. And so I actually had a ton of percussion equipment here. And I was practicing all the time. And my neighbors were very gentle with me. They were very accommodating. My guess is it would be a little more tricky right now because now everyone is home all of the time. I think it would be more bothersome. So I'd probably try to be a little bit careful about that. Yeah.
Do you ever use electronic percussion that you could listen to over headphones?
Right. I mean, I don't have any, like if you're talking about like they make these drum pads that have a few different surfaces. I don't have any of that stuff. I do have like, if I got the urge, I have like a practice pad, which is basically something that looks like a snare drum, but it doesn't make a lot of noise. And it's designed for you to just work on your technique. And so there could be all kinds of fun stuff that I could work on with that. I just haven't quite gotten there emotionally yet, I think.
Do you have any objection to using an electronic?
No, I mean, especially not right now. You know, I have no objection. I think people should be doing whatever they feel they need right now that still makes them feel like themselves. I mean, I think the thing that I'm dealing with and that so many of my friends are dealing with is our whole life, like everything about our life is tied into the music that we play. Really, it permeates every aspect. There aren't like things that are related to the job and things that are unrelated. Everything is all together. And so when you take that part out of it, it tends to make you feel like you're missing a part of yourself. I think for me right now, just because I'm so engaged with, like, I must have like 5 or 6 different meetings with composers or different groups or presenters or whatever every single day, just talking about what's going on or making plans for the future. So that's the way that I'm staying engaged right now. But I think whatever people need, like there's been so many beautiful live stream concerts that have happened that have been really cool. Whatever people need, I think is really helpful right now. I think it's also great for us as audience members too. Like we're not able to go to concerts anymore, which is such a sad thing. And so to be able to turn on Facebook and see a bunch of amazing people playing, I think is a really nice thing too. I mean, I've never gone this long without playing my instrument. I mean, not since I was like 10 or something like that. And I've really not gone this long without traveling, without being places every single, which I know is true for everyone. But you know, for me, I spent a lot of time on planes, a lot of time in different cities. And the last time that I spent this long without traveling, without performing, I mean, it's really been a long time. So it's been an interesting sort of re-examination of the things that I thought I needed to sustain me. And I wonder what I'm going to change about my life when we move past this. You know, I might find that being as busy as I was actually wasn't necessary to sustain myself, since clearly I'm doing okay right now, you know?
That is a good point. I assume a lot of working people will reassess after this is done.
Right.
To see that maybe they've found working solutions that are actually better than what they had before.
Yeah, and I think that's true for so many different industries. Like you might see businesses that used to have an office, they might decide that they didn't need that anymore because they figured out how to all do it from home, and that's a cheaper way of doing it.
I wouldn't be surprised about that, but one of the reasons people like chamber music is the intimacy of it, but you're sharing it with other people. And
yeah,
you're really not getting the same experience. Now, that still leaves open the question of, well, was that experience so important?
Right, right. No, it's a good point. I mean, I think that this has been my, like, watching these live stream concerts and even being a part of them has been a wonderful thing. And I think it's a nice Band-Aid over what we're all feeling right now. But for me, it doesn't match the feeling of being in a room with a bunch of other people experiencing something at the same time. Like I'm trying to imagine what it's going to feel like. I don't even, not even so much the first time I perform a concert, but the first time that I go to a concert when I'm an audience member, just participating in this group experience, it'll probably be a pretty emotional experience for me.
Exactly. Part of the thrill for me is the actual sound.
Yeah, yeah.
It's there's nothing like a full symphony orchestra.
Right.
And there's nothing like the ability to hear all of the voices, for example, in a string quartet or in the kind of percussion music that you're involved with. So I don't find online stuff very satisfying.
Yeah, yeah, we're all just limited by the quality of the headphones that we have to put on, you know, it's not great. Yeah, I mean, it's like, it's a physical feeling, like your body literally feels like something when you're sitting in a hall and an orchestra is playing, and you can't duplicate that.
You have individual students.
So I have 5 private students, but the way that we do it at Manus, which I really like, that there are several percussion faculty members, and we all kind of have different areas that we specialize in. Like, you know, I do a lot of the contemporary music and the keyboard percussion playing. There are other folks who do more orchestral playing or more snare drum playing. There's a chamber music person. And so at the beginning of the semester, each student gets to divide up the lessons. I can't remember, something like 15 or 16 lessons they have in a full semester. And they get to kind of choose how they want to divide up their lessons amongst the faculty members. And they're encouraged to, during their time, whether it's a 4-year undergrad, a 2-year master's, to experience a bunch of different things, at least for a little bit, to try to become a well-rounded player. And so this semester in particular, again, I was teaching 5 students, and there was a variety of amounts of lessons. Like, I think one of them I was only giving 1 lesson to, and a few others would be more lessons over the course of the semester. I'll also say that I'm brand new at this. So last semester, the fall semester, was the very first semester that I started teaching there, and I only had 1 student for a couple of lessons. So this semester was the first time I had just started kind of teaching a few of the students in person when all this happened, but it was the first time that I really felt like I was a part of that community. I am enjoying it so far, but it is very new.
Do you also teach classroom type stuff?
I haven't yet. One thing that I was attracted to when I was talking to the folks at Mass about joining them was that they have a very sort of open-ended classroom structure where they invite all the faculty members, and there are many, we're all part-time, there are many part-time faculty members who teach both private lessons and these classes, and they invite all of us to pitch class ideas to them. And they were telling me about what some of the other private lesson teachers had come up with. There was like this wonderful class with a violin teacher and a composition teacher where I think the violin teacher was teaching the violin students Bach movements from Bach pieces, and they were all learning that and talking about that. The composition students were sort of participating in the learning process of these Bach pieces. And then little by little, the composition students started to write their own solo violin pieces that the violin students started to learn. And that was a classroom class that all those students got to take. And so there's all kinds of creative things that folks are doing. So I've been thinking a little bit about that, but I haven't quite dipped my toe in the water yet.
Do you have any inclination of what you might like to do?
Well, to be honest, the thing I was mentioning a few minutes ago that I'm working on with this composition teacher right now, it feels like a very light version of what that could be. We're just doing it because we're trying to give our students some fun experiences right now during this time. But that feels like it could be the beginnings of a more fully fleshed out idea for something like that.
Do you compose yourself?
You know, I don't. It's not something that I've ever done. I've been thinking about perhaps trying to do something during this time, because if this isn't the time, then I don't think there's ever the time for someone like me who has always just said, oh, I don't have time to sit down and focus on that. Well, I really do have the time right now. So I've been thinking about trying to maybe just spend a few hours a day seeing what happens.
So it isn't for you an issue of whether you have the skills necessary to compose, but rather it's...
I would say that I definitely don't have the skills to compose at all. No, I've never been trained yet. I mean, what I do have is, you know, a very thorough knowledge of what composers have been writing for percussion over the past few years, and I know what I like. So probably what I would do is just write something that I would want to listen to, and it would probably be a bad knockoff of what someone else had done, you know?
So you've never sat down and done it?
I never have. I improvise a bit. That is something that I really do like to do, but I've never quite jumped the next hurdle to writing that down and being like, I like this. I would like to hear this a second time, you know?
What kind of stuff have you, on what instrument have you improvised?
Well, I was saying I have this synthesizer at home, and I'd like to take, you know, whether it's a jazz standard or a show tune or even a pop song or whatever, I like to sort of listen to songs like that, then learn how to play them after listening to them, and then just kind of fool around with those songs. So I guess sort of lightly improvising over the chord changes of a song that I like to listen to. I like to kind of stretch myself in those ways.
Do you have favorite composers? And I know everybody says it's the one I'm playing right now, yada yada. But are there certain people who compose for percussion that you're really into?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there are a lot of them. And actually, one thing that Sandbox is doing, which you might be interested in, every weekend, we're doing this little discussion series on our YouTube channel that we're calling Sandbox Sunday, where we invite one of our collaborators. We've been doing composers. We might stretch it out to other instrumentalists as well. But we've been featuring some composers that we think are really interesting and doing really interesting things. Like a couple weeks ago, maybe it was just last week, we featured Chris Cerrone, who I know you've heard his music before. And we featured him because right now he's writing a piece for Sandbox, for piano and percussion quartet, that we're supposed to premiere sometime over the summer. That's probably a little bit iffy right now. But he's right in the writing process right now. We thought it would be fun to bring him on and talk a little bit about what that means for him. This coming weekend, or actually I think we're doing it on Monday because Easter is on Sunday, we're featuring a young composer named Thomas Kotcheff. So he's an LA-based composer. He's someone that I went to undergrad with. That's when I first met him. He's a pianist as well. He's in an amazing piano duo called Hocket. And he's written Sandbox a couple pieces, actually three pieces, a huge piece that we featured on the album that we just released about a month ago. And so we're going to have him on because he's a great composer, he's doing really interesting stuff right now, but B, because he's an incredibly upbeat and positive person, and we thought for our own sake it would be fun to talk to someone who is so happy and so excited about everything. I thought he'd have some good things to say. Another guy that I always think of, and I know you know his music well, is Andy Akiho. He was writing a huge piece for Sandbox that we were supposed to premiere about a week from now in California. It's a 75-minute piece that we've been working on for years now, and we were so excited about it and a little bit devastated that it's not happening. But if you can find a silver lining, it's that this few weeks in here right now is not nearly as stressful as it would have been had we been trying to premiere that piece. And Andy has a lot more freedom to write. He hadn't quite finished the piece. And so now he lives out in Portland, Oregon now. Every week or so, we get a new movement via email, and it's amazing to see what he's writing right now. So he's a really, really special person. But there are so many people that are writing great music right now, and it's such a fun time to be doing this because percussion feels like it's having this resurgence, you know, or this emergence, I guess you'd call it. It's becoming something that is on the radar of every composer, and everyone seems to want to write something. One project that Sandbox was trying to do before we got a shelter in place here, right when everything started to happen, our concerts started to get canceled, we started a call for scores on Facebook. We just asked any composer who had a percussion quartet that they wanted to have read through, that it would be helpful to them to hear someone read through it. We said, just send it to us. We'll take the first 10 or 12 that we get or whatever, and we'll just read through them over a couple of hours. We'll stream it online. We'll record it so you can just hear it. We ended up getting over 80 submissions from all over the world. It was incredible. We were blown away by it. Unfortunately, right after we kind of closed that application process, we were told to stay at home. So we haven't been able to start that yet, but that's something that we're going to start as soon as we're allowed to get together again. And it felt like a nice way for us as well to get to know a whole bunch of composers that we probably wouldn't be able to get to know any other way, you know?
What's your intent with those submissions?
I mean,
like the eight intent, of them, or to choose one or two or three?
You know, especially in this moment, we were trying not to curate it. Like, we didn't want to go through them and choose things based on what we like. A, because we would probably then end up only reading a certain kind of piece because it's something that we like. But B, because we were really trying to provide a service, especially to composition students who were supposed to have recitals and performances at school that weren't happening right now. So we would like to actually go through all 80 of these. It's going to take us many months. I think it's going to take us a while to get this done. But we would like to maybe schedule a session, maybe two of them a month or something like that, where we just go to our studio for a few hours and just read through them. We're thinking we'll spend, like, I don't know, 20 minutes or so, 25 minutes per piece, kind of reading through a couple minutes of it, then maybe talking a little bit with the composer about what we think about the way that they've written certain things, the way they've laid out the score, the way they've chose instruments, and then just move on to the next one. So the idea isn't necessarily to get extremely good at any of these pieces. Of course, if we read through one of or two of them, we really love them, then it would be a great way for us to learn some new repertoire. But that wasn't the primary idea.
You saw that the Fringe is canceled this year.
I did, man. And I was just, my heart just went out forever. I was trying to imagine if all of this happened a year ago, right? If the pandemic happened last year, how we would all feel being canceled. And I just know that there are literally thousands and thousands of people and groups that are in that exact position, that have been fundraising for years, that have been rehearsing and developing this piece that is just not happening now. No guarantee that they would be able to do it the year after that, you know? It's devastating. I feel so bad for those people, and I feel so thankful that we snuck in last year, you know?
Great talking with you.
Yeah, same. I'm so glad to hear that you're healthy and sequestered where you are. So stay safe.
I'll do my best, and it is really good to see you. You're fun to talk with.
Yeah. Oh, thanks a lot. Thank you. Have a good one.
Hey, you too. Take care.
See you later.
Yeah. Bye.